is a talk in which I report the progress we have made, Ludmil Katsarkov, Laura Merseman, and Alberto Berkowski here. About this field that we have been developing is a generalization of toric geometry that we call at various times non-commutative toric geometry and quantum toric geometry, and I will explain why. And today I would like to get to the modular space and some of its properties. Unlike ordinary toric varieties, there are toric varieties are rigid and they don't admit a modular space. When you allow quantum toric varieties that generalize toric varieties, now they have a nice modular space, and I'll explain what you have to do to understand this. And I'll try to explain a very intriguing feature of this modular space that while at first doesn't seem to be, there does not seem to be a reason for it to be a complex orbifold, in essence it turns out to be a complex orbifold. So I'll try to explain what's the magic that happens there so that this is what occurs. Okay, but let's start slow and easy. And classical toric varieties are, of course, equivariant semi-compactifications of toric. Traditionally, you have some torus. I went to depict this in a not very complex way. It's some torus. It's a complex torus. And then you have a compactification, that is the toric variety. And say if it is a Kähler, projective Kähler, then you have the moment map. And, well, you know, you have this Del Sant polytope, that is sort of dual to the fan. And this is a classical picture. Now, if you take the inverse image of a point here, well, this is a complex torus, so it's a complex torus, it's fat. But the inverse image of a point, of course, gives you this Lagrangian tori, and you have this integrable system in the classical case. So this is the classical picture. So what are we going to do? Well, we're going to generalize this picture. In dimension n, there is only one complex, commutative, classical, complex algebraic torus, Cn. There's only this one. Quantum tori, there are many. So what we're going to do is where all the tori that appear in this picture, all of them, we're going to replace by quantum tori. So a quantum tori variety will be an equivariant compactification of a quantum torus. It could be Kähler or not Kähler, but in Kähler it will have a moment map. This will be because a quantum torus is a non-commutative space, this will be now a non-commutative space. And the inverse image of a point in the polytope, in the moment polytope, will be a quantum torus itself. The Lagrangian quantum torus inside this non-commutative space. But we achieved some flexibility when quantizing the system. This was an integral system, and now it will be a quantum integral system. In fact, it will be the quantization of a classical integrable system. And something that is achieved when quantizing the system is that now, this arithmetic condition for the Del Sant polytope that we used to have, it had to be a rational polytope, is relaxed, and now it doesn't need to be a rational polytope. It can be an irrational polytope, and it is a part of the program. I don't know if I will get all the way there today, but next week, if you are still here, I will get all the way there. Part of the program that we can do algebraic geometry here, even though it seems unlikely at first. So, but we can do it. So I'll try to explain how we get to that point. Any case, let me try to explain what is the quantum torus, because it's what we're trying to compactify.
So the quantum torus, it's obtained. Traditionally, this is the traditional setting, originally envisioned in the 90s, I believe, or late 80s by Alan Kohn. And so you say, let's start with the two-dimensional torus. So we take R2, and we divide by Z mod 2, the integral lattice here in R2, but we get a torus. That's a classical torus, the classical real torus. So this is an exponential map, because this is the Lie algebra, and this is the abelian real torus. But now we add a feature we put here in red. I don't know if you can see it in the back, but here we have all these red parallel lines, all the parallel lines of a fixed slope. And I will call the slope H bar, because this is the deformation parameter, and it indeed represents an actual quantum system that appears in nature. In any case, H bar is the slope of these lines, and then I project into the torus, and of course I get a foliation. And of course, there is two interesting cases. If H bar is rational, the leaves of this foliation wind around, and then they close themselves up. Then every leaf of this foliation is a torus knot. If H is irrational, though, every leaf of the foliation is dense in the entire torus. The closure of every leaf is the entire torus, and it doesn't close up on itself. And these are two very different cases. So how is this reflected in the algebra? Well, taking the Fourier transform of the convolutional algebra of the holonomy groupoid of the foliation, whatever that means, applying some algorithm to this geometric situation, to this foliation, you can get an algebra, and the algebra is non-commutative in the irrational case. Oh, I think I prevented this from happening, and now something happened. Very strange. I think I have prevented this. Okay. Anyway, I'll have to. I think I put the energy managing so that it wouldn't do this, but anyway. Anyway, there's the rational. In the irrational case, the algebra is non-commutative. It's not very non-commutative. What is non-commutative? It's xy equals e to the 2 pi I h bar yx. And if this algebra is known as a non-commutative torus. It is meant to be the algebra of functions in a hypothetical space. But spaces have commutative algebras of functions, and this hypothetical non-commutative space has a non-commutative algebra of functions. X and Y are meant to be periodic, and they don't quite commute. It's Y equals YX. This algebra, of course, coincides with the algebra that appears in a most basic quantum mechanical system. It's a pi exponential form of the Heisenberg the additive form of algebra that appears in quantum systems. And it appears in this form for the first time in Bayer's book on quantum mechanics. Anyway, this is what a lot of people refer to as the non-commutative torus. Now, for people that know this, I'm boring them to death, but let me just say that if X is rational, then the algebra looks non-commutative, and on the nose is non-commutative, but it's secretly commutative, because it's so-called Morita equivalent to a commutative algebra. So it's really commutative when H is rational, and non-commutative when H is not rational, irrational. Okay. In any case, so this is if you would want to use these algebras, and this is popular here. But you can also do an enrichment of the non-commutative algebra. You can enrich it a little bit and keep it as rather the you see, this is the so-called non-commutative quotient of this. In the rational case, it's non-commutative because the quotient is non-Hausdorff and it's very bad. It doesn't look like a manifold. And then this is why this algebra is non-commutative. But you can also do another kind of solution to the problem of bad quotients, and everybody here likes also this. Rather than using the non-commutative quotient, I'm going to use the stack quotient. So rather than
taking this non-commutative algebra, I'm going to use another avatar, I'm going to see what the image of this in a different category that preserves all the information, of course. You can recover from this category of the stacks all the non-commutative algebras at your will. But I'm going to keep the stacks. So for me, the quantum torus, in contrast to the non-commutative torus, for me, the quantum torus is going to be the stack quotient. So I'm going to take the torus, and I'm going to divide it by the group action, by the flow of this foliation. Looks like a foliation, but we have a little bit more information than just the foliation. We have the flow, the speed at which things are moving. It's a linear, regular flow. It's very simple. And we have the flow. So I'm going to take the torus module of the flow, and this, if I was in the category of topological spaces, would be a non-house of topological space. But I'm in the category of stacks, and I'll explain very, very carefully in a minute what kind of stacks I'm talking about, because people used to algebraic stacks will complain that this has no hope of being an algebraic stack. And they are right. This has no hope of being an algebraic stack because of this exponential map. So, not an algebraic stack, but a stack, and I'll explain what kind of stack. Anyway, if I take the transversal, you see, the transversal, I think of stacks as categories. Here, where the group action defines the arrows of the category, group orders. But I can take an equivalent category by just taking the transversal and skeletal category, let's say, by just taking the transversal to the torus. And while the flow in the two-dimensional torus is a linear flow, in the transversal circle, this is equivalent to taking just S1 acted on by the discrete groups with one generation rotation by h-bar. So we take rotation by h-bar, just one generator, and this group acts on the circle and is the same stack quotient and the same topological quotient and gives you the same non-commutative algebra, so you lose nothing by taking the reversal. And it's clear that the rotation contains some deformation. If I just do a cylinder with parallel lines and I rotate it and then I glue it, I recover the foliation. So I lost nothing, of course. And then I'm going to take the universal covering of this circle further. And this is going to be R. This is going to be R. This plays the role of the Lie algebra. It's going to be R. And I'm going to lift what happens with all the, you know, this leaf of the foliation that's going around and around and around. And I'm going to call it gamma, generated by 1 and h bar. Again, if h bar is rational, this gamma is just a lattice. But if h bar is irrational, this is what is called a quantum lattice by us, and a quasi-lattice by some other people. With anyway, a finitely generated additive subgroup of R will be called a quantum lattice by us. We'll just call it a quantum lattice. And notice that my quantum torus is a stack. It can be thought of as T2 divided by the real numbers acting by the flow, non-compact group, or it can be thought of as S1 divided by the rotation and all its powers, or it can be thought of as the real numbers divided by the quasi-lattice, quantum lattice, generated by 1 and h bar. This is the exponential map, this is the logarithm, this is what I call the logarithmic representation of the quantum torus, and it's very linear and it's very nice. It's just a vector space divided by a quantum lattice. That's all. And this gives you a stack. So, well, this was in R, but I could take RD. I could just take the R, the d-dimensional version of the situation. And again, what is a quantum lattice? A finitely generated additive subgroup of RD. Often enough, more often than not, is dense in RD. And this is a difference to the theory of classical toric varieties, where it is a very non-dense lattice, the rational case. The rational case looks like a lattice, and it's not dense. The quantum case looks like this quantum lattice, and it looks dense in RD. Were it not, nevertheless, form the stack of dividing RD by this quantum lattice.
And this stack is what I will call the quantum torus associated to the quantum lattice gap. Quantum torus, quantum lattice, quantum lattice, quantum torus. As easy as that. But now, rather than having only one tori in dimension n, I have a very many different tori in dimension d. So the situation is a lot more fun. And this is the definition of the quantum torus for us today. Okay. Now, what is a quantum toric stack? Well, it wants to be a compactification of a quantum torus. So, for example, what is a quantum P1? Quantum P1 with deformation parameter H bar is the quantum torus union zero, union infinity. But of course, I'm being tremendously unfair to zero and to infinity because they are very stacky points. So they have very large stabilizers at zero and at infinity. So I should write BZ or BZ here or something like that. Stacks, BZ, point stacks. But they are not points, they are point stacks. Anyway, DC1H bar. Well, how can I do it? Well, let me represent the torus in logarithmic representation. Let me apply a linear isomorphism here that sends the lattice to the lattice. And then I can glue. So I can obtain this stack by gluing these very singular stacky charts and obtaining this from the point, the algebraic point of view, hopeless stack that is extremely non-separated from the algebraic point of view. But you see it's not that bad. You think about it carefully. So and the quotient space is totally non-Hausdorff if H is irrational. Just totally non-Hausdorff if H is irrational. Okay, so what is a quantum fan? Okay. So far I told you what is a quantum lattice. But now I tell you what is a quantum fan. Well, a quantum fan is a fan. The fans you used to have together with a quantum lattice. It's just the fans from ordinary toric geometry, but I'm going to enrich it with a quantum lattice. So, I prefer to say it in the following way. It's a fan in the quantum lattice. Just that, like toric geometry, you can say it's a fan in Qn, never using the real numbers. Here I say it's a fan in the quantum lattice. This is a quantum fan. But in the past, in the traditional toric theory, one used to take the primitive vector in the different directions of the one skeleton of the fan. And now I need to be given this information. I need to mark one point in gamma in every one of these rays to know what is the primitive length in that direction. In fact, it's going to be the Planck's length in that oscillator of the quantum system. So I can have different Planck's lengths. Okay, so fans can be rational or irrational. They can be simplicial or not simplicial, just like before. They can be complete or not complete, just like before. There's a new concept, gamma complete. Gamma complete means that these V's really generate all of gamma. This is not necessary, and I really have to not think like that all the time. But it's a case, it's an interesting case. When it is so-called, we call it gamma complete. Mainly these ones generate the whole of gamma, of the quantum lattice. Anyway, I will go through this very quickly. Because it's very formal and a bit on the boring side, but extremely important for the theory. Debbie is in the detail, of course. I'm going to say now what I mean by the stacks over what? What stacks? Which stacks? So the stacks live over a site. The site of a fine toric varieties over C and toric morphisms. This is the basic site down below. So we call it A, this A for affine. Affine toric varieties with toric morphisms is the basic site where the stacks are living. So this is the basic site. Coverings and coverings. When I use analytics, Zariski opens subsets of T. That's that. And I'm going to use another important category, the category of complex analytic spaces with a holomorphic action of a complex abelianly group of the non-compact. With a holomorphic action of a complex abelianly group and with a Zariski open orbit. So this is kind of a fiber category and the base category. So this is complex analytic space. I repeat, C is complex, C for complex analytic spaces with a holomorphic action of a complex abelianly group, possibly non-compact, with a Zariski open orbit isomorphic to G. A is inside of C, of course. Okay, so these are my stacks. Quantum door stacks will be of the form, all the stacks, in fact, will always be of this form. They all will be global stacks, although it's not necessary for the theory, but it's an observation. This is a theorem later on. What is a stack? It's a category. If it was of this form, this would be the objects of the category. They would be covers over the site of toric things with B equivariant together with a map to a complex analytic G. And here I want to free the, here are tori, but here I could have non-compact things. CNs essentially. So here I have tori, but here I have more than tori. I have CNs and tori. So I unwind some of the tori, and I unwind them to allow them to have foliations and then become quantum tori. So this is, observe, for example, that classical toric varieties, now they would write it like this, because it would be preposterous, but classical toric varieties satisfy all this, are stacks over A. Classical, say, compact toric varieties, because A is only affine toric varieties. So, of course, toric varieties have the same data over affine toric varieties, and they allow you to produce one of these fibered categories with the synth data over A. Okay. Anyway, this is more of the same. This is how I would write P1 as a stack over A. And it's a bit of a ridiculous situation, but you do the exercise, and then you get that P1, this is the gluing, and the gluing produces all the descent data to produce a stack over A. So it's okay, the classical gluings will produce the descent data to produce a stack over A. Okay, so the quantum torus is one of these stacks over A. And you can write it explicitly. Here you don't need descent data. Here you just observe that here is totally non-compact. This G is the whole thing. CD acts on CD. It's abelian, it's complex analytic group acting on CD. In this case, it's the whole thing. And of course, the foliation tells you how to construct these diagrams and the same data for the category A and this stack. So, it's what you would. It's one way to formalize the idea of the quantum torus as a stack in the toric Grothendieck site. Okay, so, for example, what is a morphism of quantum tori? You go through these diagrams, definitions, blah, 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 lots of arrows, but it is a linear map from RD to RD that sends the lattice to the lattice. It's what you would expect. So, all I am saying is that these definitions of quantum toric varieties and quantum tori and all these objects as stacks over A recover the naive definitions that you would expect for morphisms and things, and recover much more. Sometimes it would be extremely hard to produce the naive definition, and this produces a machine that produces a reasonable category for these objects. Okay. Let me give another example because it illustrates this notation that's important for us. Again, take the real line, take one h bar, or h bar is square root of 2, h bar is square root of 2, and take the quantum lattice generated by 1 over and square root of 2 in R. This is dense in R. And take the linear mapping multiplication by square root of 2. Well, notice that in C mod gamma, it's just multiplication by square root of 2. And it descends to T mod gamma, exponential of gamma. And so this in exponential form is written W goes to W to the square root of 2, and it makes sense. So I can take these irrational powers dictated by gamma, and I can do my algebraic geometry with irrational powers dictated by gamma. I don't need to have rational powers anymore. So this solves the problem of irrationality. Okay. And so what is an affine quantum toric stack? So what is an affine toric variety? Well, you take a cone and you do something. You take a speck of the whatever. This generalizes that construction. Now you have a cone, say, in the gamma, in the quantum lattice. Now you have a cone in the quantum lattice, and this formula explains how to produce a stack over A that when the quantum lattice is just a lattice, is just the affine toric variety associated to the cone. So this generalizes the classical construction, but you don't need Gordon's lemma or anything like that. And it produces a nice stack over the affine side of toric variety. And you skip Gordon's lemma this way. Okay, so now you have to every cone you get an affine toric stack. Essentially you have these quantum torus and these ordinary torus, and you have portions that are ordinary tori and portions that are quantum tori, and we can count exactly how many are with which. Now what happens when I have one of these beautiful quantum fans? Can I glue the affine charts to produce a stack? So do I have enough to produce a stack over the affine side? And yeah, well, you guess now, but of course, yes. I have the cone, I straighten the cone, so I get this. This is the thing that you have the cone like this, mesh is like this, straighten. So this is the AI, and of course AI takes you your affine toric variety into a very canonical one associated to the straight thing that is the analogous of your CN. This is essentially a quantum torus partially compactified. It's as if you added the origins in C star in the classical case. Here is the quantum torus partially compactified, but in the straightened version, in this canonical form. And of course now you have AIJ, AJAI, and you can check the cocycle condition, and then you have the sent data for the stack. So you end up with all these straightened, partially compactified quantum tori, and now you got all these cocycle, machine, on one side, but it's what you expect. You just glue AIJ, AJK, la 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 la. All these letters are meant to signify what I just said, but you can use it. And then you produce a stack over the side, a global stack given to the total fan. And the fan doesn't need to be complete. Any fan. So now you have quantum toric varieties. Now you have quantum toric stacks. I don't know what to call them. Quantum toric stacks. For example, quantum P2. Quantum P2 is an interesting example. It appears in some of these quantum P2s appear in the work of
Denia, Norov, and Ludmill, but not all of them. We have all of them. So we have this fan, which is what you would expect, but now A and B could possibly be irrational. So you do the calculations, you get the gluing data, you get the gluing charts that are part, these are quantum toroid partially compactified with the origins added, so to speak. Quantum toroid partially compactified, this is an exponential form. Notice that in logarithmic form you don't know how to partially compactify. You only know how to partially compactify in exponential form, because you need to add the origins. But you do, and then, well, these are the gluing maps. Again, color is unfortunate, but here we have one of them, and 1 over A could be irrational, minus B over A could be irrational and transcendental, but it makes sense as stacks on this side. So this notation makes sense as stacks on this side. And then we can do the gluing, and we can produce the whole quantum toroid variety with this irrational ray. It's a quantum P2. Now, there is a beautiful puzzle here, and it is that in the particular case of quantum P2, where you can still compute things, you get these elaborate formulas. So if A is P over Q, and B is R over S, and alpha is the minimum, the least common multiple of Q and S, and beta is the least common multiple of S times P divided by the greatest common divisor of S, P, and Q, R, and P, etc. These arithmetic formulas that have to do with the prime factorization of these numbers, then mysteriously, every rational quantum P2 is a weighted projective space. So, we conjecture that this occurs for Pn, and moreover, in this non-calibrated case, possibly and probably for quantum torics, so that you have the modular space of quantum P2s, the rational points of the modular space of quantum P2s are the weighted projective P2s. But the proof is surprisingly unenlightening, and it's a calculation. But why we are getting all the rational points are exactly the bodies of stacky ones or whatever, bodies of chain stacky ones rather than anything else. So it is a nice puzzle. And this transform that goes from AB to alpha, B, beta, R is also an extremely interesting mapping, number theoretic mapping. So, well, this is a bit of a mystery, but nevertheless, in this case, it's true. And so the rational ones are the weighted projective spaces, and the irrational ones are truly quantum. So the same dichotomy for the quantum toroids. Rational is the classical thing. Irrational is the truly quantum non-commutative toric varieties. Okay, now we will turn on the germ. This is a response to the following problem. Say that you have this foliation, and you start to move H bar. This is what we want to do to produce modular spaces. Vary H bar. Let's see if we can do H bar. Well, vary H bar. We want to move H bar, the slope of the red lines, to produce the modular space of quantum toroid. But this is going to, a modular space it will be, but it will be a very bad modular space if it kind of will jump all over around, because even the dimension of the Gaussian will be wrong if I say that it's an R action when it's irrational and a circle action when it's rational. I don't want to think as a circle action when it's rational. I want to think of it as an R action when it's rational. I can think of a circle action as an R action, except that the quotient will be, one will be a gerb over the other. It will be a set stabilizer everywhere in the rational case.
So in the rational case, this will be a commutative thing made non-commutative by turning on kind of a silly degree of freedom, sort of discrete B-field, gerb. So we turn on the gerb, and now all of them form a nice modular space. So to regularize the modular space, we want to turn on the gerb. And in a way, the quantum torus knows this gerb is there. So it's not so natural, you know? So I will turn on the gerb. To turn on the gerb, well, what you have to do is to take gamma in the quantum lattice. You want to take gamma in the quantum lattice. And you want to take a higher dimensional, nice lattice. This is a Zn, this is an Rd, and you want to produce an H bar. Well, I will call it H because A is more like I plus H bar. You want to produce an H that this nice discrete lattice sends it into the dense gamma lattice. And these then will count the gerb. This will count the gerb, and it will solve that problem. So it's a little bit of a technical thing. I hope I conveyed it. But you can ignore it if you don't feel like thinking about it. And just ignore it. By the way, it's the calibrated case. It's your turn on the gerb. So if you start with a calibrated quantum fan, you can do now, you can also do it without calibration. It's easier with calibration. Everything starts to be easier with the calibration. So I use the calibration. Now we can do quantum geometric invariant theory. So we want to do the geometric invariant theory for this quantum space, for these non-commutative spaces. So we do. So we'll do this quantum geometric invariant theory. I'll give you the explicit formulas. It amounts in the language of the polytope theory to the gain transform. So if we have these vectors, you remember these were the mark points. These were the mark points of the fan. These were the mark points in every ray of the fan, the VIs. Well, I do the gain transform to the mark points of the fan, and I get the AIs. And the AIs, so well, this is the relation between the AIs and the VIs. So this is the, it's a duality. I get the gain transform. And, well, once I get the gain transform, I get the usual open complex affine toric variety. I get the usual affine toric variety, that is Zn minus some axis of various dimensions. And the A give me an exponential action on this affine toric open set in such a way that the quantum toric variety is S mod A. This is geometric invariant theory. As I took the points, I just kept the semi-stable points, I threw out the other points. This is where I throw out the points. And now I have an action. It's a linear exponential action. And the quantum toric variety can be expressed this, giving you a version of the Cox ring for the quantum case. But notice now that this Cox ring will have irrational numbers all over the place. But they make sense in this world, in these stacks over A. Okay. Anyway, the non-calibrated case can be done thinking not of the action, but of the foliation. If you, rather than the action, take just the foliation on the affine toric variety,
and compute the whole holonomic group point and stackify the whole holonomic group point. The stackification of the whole holonomic group point is a non-calibrated quantum toric. So the difference between the calibrated quantum toric stack and the non-calibrated quantum toric stack is that one takes the group action seriously and the other one takes only the foliation. And this is the difference between the calibrated quantum toric and the non-calibrated quantum toric. The calibrated quantum toric takes seriously the group action, and the non-calibrated quantum toric only consider the canonical foliations. Okay, so, well, we have achieved what we promised. Now we have this thing, and in the Kähler case, in the case in which the fan is polytopal, if the fan is polytopal, then we have this picture with quantum toric, and inverse images of points are real Lagrangian quantum toric, and this is a compactification of a complex quantum torus, and it's a non-commutative space that satisfies everything I said. Okay. Now there's a relation to a beautiful theory that I will not do justice to, because it's an elaborate, beautiful, sophisticated theory developed throughout many years by López de Medrano, and Verkhovsky, and Merzeman, and Bosio, and it's called LBMB theory. I should expose the LBMB theory, but it's more complicated, so I will explain the LBM theory very briefly. And the LBMB theory is a generalization of the LBM theory. And sorry, all the aspects of the theory are important, but I will lie a little bit from now on, because I need the LBMB theory, but I will only speak about the LBM theory. So I will lie a little bit. But anyway, you have a configuration. Imagine that M is 1, and that you have a configuration of complex numbers. 7:30, don't forget. So that you have a configuration of complex numbers. These are the lambdas. And these essentially, the lambdas are essentially, do you remember the A's that were the Gale transform of the V's? Do you remember the V's? Gale transform gave you the A's? Well, the lambdas are A1 plus I A2. So you get the lambdas, and now you produce a nice dynamical system. And you ask, these are the input for a dynamical system, and you ask two conditions coming from dynamics, the Siegel condition and the whole weak hyperbolicity condition. And then, well, you look at this dynamical system and you see the modular space of flows and blah, blah, blah. But it can be reduced to really explicit definitions. Absolutely explicit definitions, inspired by, from dynamical systems. Differential equations, whatever you want to call it. And then you get a very interesting complex non-Kähler manifold associated to these numbers. It's a fascinating complex non-Kähler manifold associated to these numbers. In our world, these numbers will come from the V's by Gale transform and then complexification. Well, not complexification, I don't know. Observing that they are the real part of a complex thing. The other way around, by taking the real and imaginary part of this and doing the Gale transform, you get the V's. And indeed, this is more or less here, you get a foliation, a holomorphic foliation here. This is a complex non-Kähler manifold that carries a God-given holomorphic foliation. It just always knows it's holomorphic foliation. Just knows this foliation. And, well, theorem, this generalizes a theorem of Alberto and Loral, Merzeman. The non-calibrated quantum toric variety is the quotient by the foliation. And the calibrated quantum toric variety, well, is the quotient by the actual flow. Anyway, this non-Kähler manifold is transversally Kähler. Therefore, these stacks are Kähler. So, in the polytopal case, that is this case in which you can do this. In the polytopal case, that is this case in which you can do this, these end up being Kähler stacks over A. So, that is the most interesting case. But of course, there is the other toric varieties, don't get me wrong. I also love them. You love or you're doing the same, but some of them are special. Anyway, so these are the Kähler ones. And this is a sort of Kähler geometric invariant theory. They acquire a symplectic form, and well, they have a Kähler cone, but you can pick a point in the Kähler cone, and you get a particular irrational point. Irrational point. Okay. And again, the difference between the calibrated and the non-calibrated is the same as in the case of quantum torus, is the difference between taking the flow and taking just the holonomy groupoid of the foliation. This means the stackification of the holonomy groupoid of this foliation, what it means. And this means really the quotient stack. Here we wouldn't know what the quotient by. And we mean we take the holonomy groupoid, we stackify the holonomy groupoid, and we take the stack. Okay, so that's that. But I almost forgot, and this is extremely important. There is this dichotomy between the rational and the irrational case. In the rational case, you get, you get all the classical ones, and we suspect only those, but there is this. It's a non-theoretic question whether all of the rational ones are the classical ones. And I don't know today. Because it naively looks like a very hard non-theoretic question at the moment. But maybe we're not seeing something. Anyway, possibly all the possibly only the classical ones, but definitely all the classical ones. I'm saying something wrong. For this is known that this is all the classical ones. For the Kähler case. I mean, in the general case. In the Kähler case, we know that these are exactly the classical ones. And the calibrated ones, well, these are interesting. And what's the relation between the calibrated and the non-calibrated one again? Well, in a way, for the smallest possible calibration, there is many calibrations. It's a new degree of freedom. How much you want to calibrate, how much air you want to put. But if you put kind of the minimum amount of air, this behaves like the two-fold holomorphic homotopy cover of this. So this kind of remembers this, and this kind of remembers this. So they are not. They are not truly different in the, and of course in the irrational case they are totally isomorphic. There is no stabilizers. In the generic most irrational case, they are the problem is when the rational case, that is the classical case. In that case, this is kind of a little non-commutative enhancement of this, but this one knows this degree of freedom, always new. But I could put more and more calibration. I could put more and more calibration. I mean, this H could go from an enormous Rn. And the more and more calibration I put, the more gear I put here, then this no longer knows this. It's an extra information, it's extra degrees of freedom. And these are very important degrees of freedom, because dramatically they singularize the modular space. It's like, this is the analogous, putting how many gears you put, how many gerbiness you put, call it N, and call the combinatorial type of the fan G. I know it's a crazy name. Call the combinatorial type of the fan G, and call how much gear you put N.
right? But the other way around, sorry. So call G the combinatorial type of the fan. Call G the combinatorial type of the fan and N how much ger degrees of freedom you put. And this is the analogy. In the modular space of curves, G was the combinatorial type of the surface. And N was how many mark points you were putting to make nicer the modular space. Well, here, it's a given, the combinatorial type of the fan, G. And N is how much gers you are putting to make nicer the modular space. So we have exactly these two variables in our modular space. So don't get lost, because now lots of letters appear, but think of this. This is will be called D eventually, the combinatorial type of the fan, and this will be called some number. I don't know which one. How much gear you put. Anyway, modular spaces, let's start by the modular space of quantum tori. Calibrated, remember. Even when it's a torus knot, I think it's R winding around over and over. And they are complex, of course. They are complex. Well, one can prove that it is a stack, but it's a very complicated equivalence relation. You see? It's Rd, it's of dimension d times n minus d. And this is going to be the general behavior. All our modular spaces will be modular spaces of this dimension. So it's R, D, N minus D, and this extraordinarily complicated equivalence relation. But of course, notice that it's an arithmetic group, the one that is active. And it will always be the case for all my modular spaces. We'll have this arithmetic group active. So, well, whatever it is there. It's complicated to be studied. You're interested? But it's a beautiful, it's a beautiful fact that. And now we tie in with non-commutative geometry. The classical non-commutative algebras, Morita equivalence, all that story, now we tie in. The modular space coincides with Riffle's modular space of non-commutative tori. The same modular space. So we expect this is the same. And in this case, this guy. I mean, you go through Riffle's proof, and yes, it's the same. Except that here, it's actually much easier to find this formula than it is for algebras. And for algebras, it's a horrendous task. It's very difficult. And I don't mean horrendous that is not elegant. I just mean it's a very difficult task. And here, it's linear algebra. It's very easy. It's much easier to deal with this task than with the non-commutative algebras. In this case, I could add, calibration, and then it gets better when I add calibration. It gets so much simpler. So it's this phenomenon that I'm telling you about. This is already a modular space of toric varieties, except they are the ones with the trivial fan that only has the trivial cone. But you already see this phenomenon, that I added calibration, the stack improved dramatically. It became so much simpler, so much nicer. And of course, one covers the other. So you're kind of singularizing the stack to make it nicer and nicer and nicer as you add these gerb degrees of freedom. Okay, so let's go for gamma complete. Remember, gamma complete, the V generator of gamma, simplicial quantum toric varieties, modular space of gamma complete simplicial quantum toric varieties. Again, it's a beautiful theorem that it is a real orbifold of this dimension in the gamma complete case. This is essentially with the minimum amount of jerk. It's already pretty good. P2, for example, one can compute P2 explicitly. And the modular space of P2s is this orbifold, this beautiful formula. That's the modular space of P2s. Here I depict the modular space of P1s inside. And the most distinguished point, 0,0, is P2 itself. The one with more symmetry, more stabilizer. And then you lose stabilizers, you know, as a fan loses symmetries. And then you get these nice orbitals. Beautiful orbitals. These are the two generations of STD. Theorem, well, again, these formulas get a little bit more interesting, fascinatingly elaborate, but it's a beautiful, although I don't know if people have found it in other fields, but let me say it's a beautiful new orbital that deserves to be studied, this, the modular space of toric. Notice that I am fixing the combinatorics of the fan. And later on I would like to start gluing these spaces in a grand combinatorial structure. But for now, I have fixed the combinatorial of the fan, and I'm obtaining the charge of this other hypothetic grand majestic modular space. For now, this we have this modular space, and these are beautiful orbitals. The formulas are interesting and not entirely trivial. The computation is not trivial, but it's linear algebra, and this can take some time. But it can be performed by computer. But, well, the formula starts to get complicated enough that it deserves to be understood. What's going on? But this is only for PM. Remember, we have all torics. This is only for P2 and it's only for PM. Now, the calibrated case, well, if I add enough ger, and I ensure that it's of the right even dimension thing, then a miracle happens. This is a miracle. This is a miracle. For the projected space, the following is a miracle. It's a complex orbital. This complex structure comes from LBN theory out of the blue. This is entirely miraculous that this is a complex orbital. And this is the magic of LBM theory. But it becomes Laurent Merzeman, our great collaborator, has developed the deformation theory of the stacks necessary to prove all these things. Godard, Spencer, and all those things. So he has the deformation theory of these very general stacks, analytic and very general. And so, using LBM theory, one can prove that this is a complex orbital. This is a miracle. I don't know. I don't have a rational explanation of this fact, just a proof. Okay. More generally, for torics in general, the modular space of LBM B manifolds, never talked to you about the additional conditions of LBM B, well, it has a sort of a Dyke-Müller space. It has this open set of CM times n minus n, but I never told you what is one of these numbers. I never told you what it is, so don't ask what the other number is. Something that I skipped in the talk, and I warned you I was going to skip one of these numbers. But anyway, again, a sophisticated action of an arithmetic group on this Dyke-Müller space. And it's a complex orbital. So we have this Dyke-Müller space of LBMB manifolds. And the final theorem, 559 with 37 seconds, is the final theorem is the modular space of quantum toric varieties is homotopy equivalent. It's not even homeomorphic to this space. But it is homotopy equivalent to this space. So it is a homotopic complex structure. It's a homotopic enhancement into a complex orbifold. And this generalizes this miracle. This miracle for PD. Well, this is a slightly lesser miracle, nevertheless a miracle for any toric, for any fixed combinatorics. For any fixed combinatorics, and some arithmetic minor condition, very easy to fulfill. Enough ger. You don't put enough ger, there is no hope. That's why I have to put the B here, of Bosio. LBM wants to do it. I need to put the B here to put enough ger,
then this modular space becomes homotopy equivalent to this complex orbital. And this is what I promised in the abstract, a complex structure octohomotopy in the modular space of quantum toric varieties. Thank you very much. Omega is the place where these lambdas satisfy the CL condition and the weak hyperbolicity condition. It's an open set of C something. It's an open set of C something.
Is there some, is it something like, I think it's something like
purely. It's purely combinatoric, Omega. It's purely combinatoric. It's just taking off something, you know, that kind of.
Purely domain, complex domain.
I cannot hear you from here, Mike.
Some complex domain should arise from curiosity.
Well, I don't know. Probably. I didn't think of it like that. That's probably the first. It's a measurement.
It's a complement of certain subspaces of different dimensions given by the lambdas that you described.
That's right.
So it's a point
it's purely combinatoric.
Yeah. So it's an open set CBM, which is a very easy. Sabisky orbit, exactly the complement of certain configurations of spaces, different dimensions.
Any other questions?
This is H, this lambda is another avatar for H bar. And it moves the Planck length of the quantum system, of the coupled quantum system.